Hey gang, Scott Davenport here. Well, I put out a call for photo questions and you've asked a bunch of them. It's great. I'm going to grab a few of them here right now, read them out, and give you my honest, immediate thoughts and feedback on them. So let's get into it. Question from Jorge, and he asks, I'm a Nikon shooter and I always convert my RAW files to DNG when importing them into Lightroom. Recently, I read somewhere that I may be compromising the full potential of my photos by not working on the native NEF files. Should I change my workflow? So the short answer to that is yes, I think you should change your workflow and just use the NEF files. But my reasoning for that isn't because I'm concerned about the quality of the raw data. It's more about just burning time. You know, when you're converting to DNG, that takes time. And I'm not aware that Lightroom will process a DNG file any better or worse than it will process a Nikon RAW file or a Sony RAW file or a Fuji RAW file, Canon, Olympus, name your RAW file format. I think when DNG first got created, it was from the perspective that it would be a standard RAW format that everybody would use. And in practice, that's just not what happened. What I can say is there is something about the manufacturer's software, like Nikon in your case, in theory, would know their RAW format better than any other software because they invented the RAW format. And most times that information isn't shared with third-party vendors like Adobe or On1 or Skylum or Capture One, any of the folks that are creating RAW processors. So there's some reverse engineering that happens. But in practice, I don't think that you'll get a better result as far as losing data or something like that by converting to DNG, but you are losing time. So I'd just work with the direct RAW file out of your camera, in your case, Nikon, for anyone else, whatever camera manufacturer you're using, just use their RAW file and go with it. And I'm not worried that we won't be able to read those files in the future. There'll be software somewhere that can read them. Ron asks, how do I work as a photographer and live in La Jolla? So tongue planted firmly in cheek, I think, here from Ron. Ron and I have shot together a couple of times. And a sidebar, if you're into woodworking, check out Ron Polk's channel on YouTube. There's some really amazing stuff there. I'm not very good with my hands, and to watch someone who is and build things, it's pretty great. So, for those that don't know, La Jolla, it's an area I shoot in often. I do not live in that neighborhood. It is beyond my price point. It's an expensive place to live because it is so beautiful. And so how do you live there and work as a photographer? I suppose you could have 10 roommates or you could sleep in a tent, tongue in cheek and flippant comments aside, like anywhere else, right? You'd have to cater to a particular market. Maybe it'd be upscale weddings, upscale event photography, real estate, or just a whole lot of hustle and, just working. So, could it be done? I'm sure. I mean, there's more than one photographer that live in that area, but it would be a tougher racket. My advice would be maybe live one town over, and then you can drive in or cycle in and still enjoy the beaches. This question is from Mark, and he asks, I'm a beginner photographer, and I'm wondering what you do with your JPEGs after processing. Do you delete them after, say, printing or posting, store them in a processed file, something else? Now, what are my options for processed images besides posting or printing them? Well, there's a bunch of different options, but let me answer the workflow question first. For the most part, once I've exported a JPEG, that's usually just for sharing, either posting to my website, putting on Instagram, and so it's a relatively low resolution file, and I don't keep those around. I'll delete them. There's no need for them to take up more space on my hard drive because I can always recreate them later and I might need a different resolution. Now, I did a recent video on saving master edits, a similar question to yours. And there is a use case for me to save like my master edits for the very, very best photos that I want. So check out that video, but really it's not for every single photo that I might share or export. So what are the other options to use them besides just, great, I've processed a photo and now it's either locked away on my computer. You know, photo books, you mentioned that in your question, that's certainly an option. Printing them, like I've got them on the walls there. One other thing I'll advocate is just digital picture frames, whether that be an iPad, you know, a smart TV, or just, you know, your phone. I'll take collections of photos and sync them to Lightroom. I'm using Lightroom. Sync them to Lightroom Mobile on my phone, so I have them. And when I'm talking with friends or, you know, meeting people and we start talking about photos, I have them in my hand and I can share them. And that's another way to use your processed photos. Now, I think for the phone sync, if you're using a program that has a mobile component, you know, Lightroom has one, On One has one, I'm not sure about others, then you don't really need those JPEGs you've exported. But you could also just export a set of photos and put them into Google Drive, Dropbox, Apple Photos if you're using Mac products, and have them in your pocket to be able to share. And that's one of the ways I like to keep around images or JPEGs if they're not in my Lightroom catalog. Next question is about printing from the user Seawater, who asks, did you frame and print the photos on the wall behind you? And is it imperative to calibrate your printer as well as your monitor? So yes, I did print all of these on the Epson P800 that I have here in the studio, and just got some basic frames off of Amazon, so they're nothing particularly fancy. So these are inkjet prints done on Red River paper. That particular one was a metallic type of sheen to it. And so is it important to calibrate your printer and monitor, or imperative, I think was the word you used. It's not imperative. You can get very good prints without doing any calibration and letting the printer manage colors. And I think about half of the ones that are on the wall behind me were done before I started calibrating my printer. I have a whole different series of videos on printer and monitor calibration. The important thing there is if you're going to go down the route of calibrating your printer with a device like the i1 Studio that I use, you also need to calibrate your monitor. You need to have a calibrated workflow and environment. Calibrating just the printer by itself doesn't really get you anything, because you want to have your monitor calibrated by the same device so that the color you see on your monitor will match the color you see on the print. Watch the printing series that I've got. There's a playlist on YouTube where you go to my website, and on the Learn tab, there's a printing section. I have a whole bunch of videos there for you that will dig into this topic a lot deeper. Question from Knowles, and he asks, what do you dislike about YouTube photographers? Well, that's an interesting question for me to answer, considering I'm answering this on YouTube as a photographer. I think I understand the spirit of the question. And I will answer, but really not just to YouTube photographers, but to photographers in general. And I think it's closed-mindedness, you know, or controversy for controversy's sake, where there is just, you know, you entrenched yourself in a certain position or stance, and you will not even consider that there are alternatives. And the thing that I guess rubs me the wrong way about that is there's always alternatives, and those alternatives may not be for you, but they do exist, right? If there were no alternatives, then we'd all have the same camera, we'd all process photos in the same way, we'd use the same tools, you know, all that stuff. And so those are the things that kind of, you know, rub me the wrong way, especially when it doesn't necessarily help someone advance their photography. I like to think that when I do these videos, I'm putting in enough, wiggle room or gap to say, here's how I do something, and there may be other ways, and those ways can be equally, you know, result equally in a great photo, because that's ultimately what matters, at least to me, is the photo. So, you know, Neil, I hope that kind of answers the question. If I didn't get the spirit of your question right, leave a comment and let me know what you think. Well, that's the set of questions for today. I'll put together another video. So if your question didn't get answered, don't worry. You know, check back in a little bit, and I'll have another one of these put together. And if you've got another question, please ask it in the comments below. I'd love to hear what's on your mind photographically. And if, you know, this type of video is working for folks, we'll keep on doing them. Well, until next time, my name's Scott Davenport, and happy shooting.